So I think we are now a bit past three, so I would like to start and welcome everybody to the first D-BSSE eSymposium. So as many of you know, we had weekly seminars with invited guests from all over the world. For this fall semester, we decided to place that by a bit longer eSymposia, which happen not every week, but every few weeks. And so those meetings will be online as well as then later available on a recording, at least most of them. So welcome today on this eSymposium. And the first symposium is on, why we all can't travel, namely SARS-CoV-2. So what do SARS-CoV-2 genomes tell us about the evolution and spread? And we all hope, obviously, that you will like this symposium. And if you want to be updated about future symposia and what's happening anyways at the D-BSSE during those difficult times, here are all the different contact details for reaching us. And so this brings me directly to our program for today. So we are very happy to start with a keynote by Katia Koelle, then followed by talks from different members of the department working on SARS-CoV-2. And so let me directly go and discuss and introduce Katia Koelle. She's an associate professor at Emory University in the US, and she studies ecological, evolutionary, and within-host dynamics of RNA viruses affecting humans, meaning she's perfectly prepared to look at the SARS-CoV-2 pandemic. And actually looking at the genomes, she investigated outbreaks in Israel as well as different regions in the US. And I'm sure a lot of other things she will tell us about. So Katia, we are very happy to have you today, at least virtually with us. And Katia will tell us about SARS-CoV-2 phylodynamics with and without phylogenies.
Great, thank you. Can you hear me? First, a big thanks to Tanja and to Niko and to Tim for the invitation. This group in Basel is a fantastic group, so I'm really lucky to be able to present some of our recent work, both in published and in press, as well as in prep. Okay, can everyone see my screen?
Perfect.
Fantastic. Okay, great. Well, Tanja already introduced a little bit about what my lab is about, but I know not everyone kind of knows my work. So what I'd like to do first in the first minute or so is just to give a little bit of description of what my lab focuses on. As Tanja mentioned, we work primarily on looking at RNA viruses in humans, particularly on flu over the last 10, 15 years. And we look at flu evolution and flu epidemiological dynamics kind of together by looking at both time series data as well as viral genetics. We work at multiple different scales. Let me just change my pointer. Okay, so we work at multiple different scales. So we're interested in virus evolution at the population level, virus evolution during individual transmission events for things like characterizing transmission bottlenecks, and then also looking at patterns of within-host diversity and evolution. And so we've been in the past working with dengue, with flu, a little bit of norovirus, but in the last, of course, 6 to 8 months, our lab has shifted over into looking predominantly at SARS-CoV-2 dynamics. And what I'd like to talk about today are three different projects that are in various stages. The first project is a phylodynamic analysis that we did in collaboration with Adi Stern at Tel Aviv University. This has been published at this point. The second one is actually in prep work with two graduate students in my group, Youngson Park and Mike Martin, on more methods development, effectively using or doing phylodynamics without phylogenies. And the third project I'd like to talk about is a project with Dave Van Insbergi and Anise Lohan and Andy Nish, focused on identifying SARS-CoV-2 recombination or recombinants at the population level. Okay, so just as a little bit of background, it's pretty well known at this point if you've been reading Science and Nature over the last, over the last 6 months, that SARS-CoV-2 sequences are very informative in terms of being able to identify kind of where viral introductions have come from into a region. So this is a high-profile study looking at Northern California, with an indication kind of from the viral sequences that there's been multiple introductions into Northern California. This is another analysis for looking at New York City data, indicative also of multiple introductions into kind of a focal region. As you know, some of you probably also know very, very well, sequences can also be used to infer the dynamics of spread within a region. So this is an example from Samuel Alizon's group where they used a birth-death phylodynamic model, which has been, of course, developed largely kind of by Tanja Stadler and her group, where they look at around 200 SARS-CoV-2 genomes from France, and they estimate what R naught is over these three different epochs. So sequences can be used to infer kind of R naught and how it varies over time in a specific region. Another example of this of these viral sequences being used to infer patterns of spread comes from Eric Volta's group. Here they use 59 sequences from Portugal, and using a coalescent-based phylodynamic approach, they were able to infer both R naught as well as the cumulative number of infections over time and the effective reproduction number over time. And what you can see here in orange is actually the actual data, case data. Okay, so many of you know this really like the back of your hand. For those of you who don't, how do we do this type of analysis? How do we actually infer epidemiological dynamics from viral sequence data? So this basically relies on general kind of population genetic models. So here I'm describing it within kind of a coalescent-based framework. This is some of Denise Kuhnert's work. So what you can see here is just a very kind of standard, you know, Wright-Fisher type model where you have individuals in a population, you know, that have these generations, right? And you have kind of offspring from one generation to the next, right? And you can kind of sample individuals shown here in red at different points in time. And then you could presumably kind of trace back the ancestry, right? And so with that, you would get, you know, something that looks like this genealogy. Here, instead of just individuals in the population, we think of these individuals as being infected individuals, right? And birth is actually a transmission. So basically what we can do is we can use viral sequence data, and viral sequence data you can be used to infer phylogenies. And these phylogenies and their coalescent timings are informative of the underlying population size of infecteds. And so what you see here on the right-hand side is that in growing populations, there are certain characteristics of the timing of the coalescent events that would allow you to kind of infer what the epidemiological dynamics are doing over time, right? So here in growing populations, coalescent events occur closer to the root of the tree, as you can see here. And so these coalescent timings are informative of population sizes of infecteds. So how do we infer things like R naught? Well, an epidemiological model under a certain parameterization, let's say under a certain R naught value, gives us a certain trajectory of infected individuals, right? And a different R naught value will give you a different trajectory of infected individuals, right? And since infected individuals are effectively the population sizes that are of interest in terms of the virus, right? We can use the timing of the coalescent events in a phylogeny to infer the model parameters. For R naught, because the coalescent events are informative of these underlying infected dynamics. Okay, so with that little bit of background, which is totally bored Tanja at this point, what I want to do is jump into the phylodynamic analysis that we did in collaboration with Adi Stern's group, looking at Israeli sequences. And this was largely spearheaded by Danielle Miller, who's a graduate student in Adi's group, and Mike Martin, who's a graduate student in my group. Okay, so the data that we had available from sequencing that was done in Adi's group and in related labs in Israel were 212 full genome SARS-CoV-2 sequences. And these SARS-CoV-2 sequences range from being sampled kind of at the end of February through the end of April. And what you can see in this phylogeny where you have these blue dots are just the Israeli sequences. Danielle first kind of performed ancestral state reconstruction using this phylogeny to actually determine how SARS-CoV-2 came into Israel and how it spread in Israel, right? And so you can see here that, you know, here are the different districts in Israel, right? And you can see that the majority of sequences, introduction events actually stem from the US. There are some that actually also stem from Europe, but US was the primary contributor. And there was also spread within Israel between districts. And so we have this disproportionate seeding from the US that became apparent. So about 70% of the clade introductions came from the US. And in Israel, they had very detailed epidemiological records. And so when individuals kind of came into, flew into Israel, they actually tested pastures and so forth. And so it turns out that about approximately 27% of reported infected returning travelers were from the US. So the number of clade introductions that actually stemmed from the US was disproportionate compared to kind of what was expected, right? And that could be potentially because of, you know, behavior, you know, of people who came in from the US or their contact rates with certain communities, but it was disproportionately introduced, SARS-CoV-2 was disproportionately introduced from the US. Okay, what I want to focus on today though is more the phylodynamic analysis that we contributed to this project. And so what we basically kind of did was use some of Eric Boltz's coalescent-based approaches to estimate R-naught and to estimate changes in R-naught due to social distancing measures in Israel. And so the underlying model we used is this SEIR model that many of you are familiar with. So an SEIR model is one which compartmentalizes the population of hosts into susceptible individuals, exposed and infected but not yet infectious, infected and infectious individuals, and recovered individuals. And we parameterize this on about 3 days of people being in this exposed class, 5.5 days on average being in this infected class. And what we wanted to do was estimate effectively R naught, right? And R naught we could estimate by inferring this transmission rate, right, and multiplying it by this 5.5 days to give us this R naught. Okay, so that's kind of our base model. We also incorporated transmission heterogeneity. And so why even consider transmission heterogeneity? Well, this is very important, especially for kind of viral infectious diseases, and it's been shown to be very important for SARS-CoV-2 in particular. So this is just an example, kind of showing kind of one of these transmission clusters from a bar. And you can see that kind of bars can be these places where a single individual who comes in can generate a lot of secondary infections, right? Whereas someone else who might be infected might generate zero infections. So there could be a very large degree of transmission heterogeneity. And so there was a very nice analysis, years ago in the seminal paper by Jamie Lloyd Smith, where they looked at the extent of transmission heterogeneity in emerging infectious diseases. And they found that there was quite a bit. Here, this line is kind of the 20-80 rule that most infectious 20% of individuals are responsible for 80% of the secondary cases. And at that point, you know, they looked at SARS here, SARS-CoV-1, which has even more transmission heterogeneity than that. And so estimates currently from literature, if you've read this literature, it seems to be that there's quite a bit of transmission heterogeneity for SARS-CoV-2, and that it could be on this order, if not higher. Okay, so we decided to, you know, we need to kind of extend this model to account for that transmission heterogeneity, because transmission heterogeneity is known to affect rates of coalescence. And so we extended the epidemiological model, like Eric Bulls had previously done also in his work on looking at Ebola dynamics. So here now, instead of having one class of infecteds, we have two classes of infecteds, individuals who have low transmission rate, individuals who have high transmission rates. And we can parameterize the relative infectiousness of these two different infection classes such that this IH class accounted for 80% of the new infections. And then what we were interested in is knowing kind of, well, what percent of exposed individuals became highly infectious and what remaining percent went to this low infectious class. Because basically this pH value then tells you, you know, if it's 5 or something like that, it means that 5% of the most infectious individuals are responsible for 80% of the transmissions. So we're interested in kind of understanding also what that pH value was. If it's 0.2, that's basically goes along with this rule in disease ecology of kind of this 20-80 rule. If that pH was 0.8, basically means that 80% of the most infectious individuals resulted in 80% of the secondary infections, so there's no transmission heterogeneity there. And for an extreme levels of super spreading would be associated with pH values less than 0.2. Okay, and the final thing that we had to consider is kind of this outside reservoir. As you all know, if you kind of look at a phylogeny and you kind of trace back the different lineages, sometimes those lineages that are in a focal region, like in Switzerland, leave the focal region and those lineages would then be circulating in, let's say, Germany or Italy, right? And so we had to incorporate that outside reservoir into our analysis. And the final thing with this model was that we allowed R naught to change on March 19th, which is when these social distancing measures were put into place in Israel. Okay, so some of our results here. So the R naught before March 19th that we estimated was between 2 and 3, and this depended in part on the level of transmission heterogeneity that we assumed. So instead of actually trying to estimate transmission heterogeneity, what we tried to do instead was look at these different values of transmission heterogeneity to see how sensitive our results were to them. And so what you can see is that these R-naught estimates range again between 2 and 3, so not a wide range over these different possible ranges of transmission heterogeneity. Then if we look at R-naught after March 19th, so alpha is the proportion of kind of that original pre-March 19th R-naught this is the factor to which it changed. And so you can see here alpha is on the order of about 0.3, 0.4, which means that R naught after March 19th was reduced by kind of 60 to 70%. Okay, so then we wanted to really get at kind of, well, do we have an idea of how much super spreading there is? There was extensive surveillance over this time period in Israel. And so we know from this surveillance that the reported incidence on April 22nd was right here kind of at this dashed level, right? And so this is likely to some extent an underreporting, right, of incidence, but it might not be a significant underreporting. And so what we have here is the cumulative incidence expected from our model. And so you can see that under transmission heterogeneity is about 2 to 10%. This is consistent with the reported incidence levels, you know, especially on the order of kind of 5% of the most infectious individuals being responsible for 80% of the secondary infections. So we think that this is, whereas kind of these levels of transmission heterogeneity are not consistent with reported incidence, right? And so this provides kind of support through epidemiological data that there's substantial transmission heterogeneity in SARS-CoV-2 transmission in Israel. Okay, and like has been done in some of Eric Volz's previous work, what we were able to do kind of from our model, fitted model, was then just simulate the number of infecteds over time under these different transmission heterogeneities and also just cumulative incidence levels. And these are black dots are data from surveillance. Okay, so conclusions with respect to the Israel analysis, there seems to be an extreme amount of viral super spreading in Israel. And most clades that were introduced, or most kind of transmission changes that were introduced into Israel, actually came from the US. And the third kind of take home message is that R naught, we estimated to be between 2 and 3 initially, and that social distancing measures were actually really effective at the end of March and into April, and they really reduced transmission considerably to an R naught of about, 0.3 times, you know, 2 or so, you know, so reduced to below 1 for sure. Okay, so transitioning on to kind of the next part of the talk. This part of the talk is the least fleshed out. This is work that's actually in prep right now, and I would love to get feedback from the group on this. So this part of the talk focuses more on methods development, specifically developing some phylodynamic methods that don't actually rely on phylogenies. And this is in collaboration again with Yongsung Park and Mike Martin, both of who are graduate students in my group. Okay, so we know that there are limitations to tree-based phylogenetic inference at this point in time, mostly because there's a huge amount of phylogenetic uncertainty. This is a virus that's evolving relatively slowly compared to other RNA viruses. And so this is one of these densities, just showing the extent of phylogenetic uncertainty we have for SARS-CoV-2. The other limitation of tree-based phylodynamic inference, at least when you're using these coalescent-based analyses, is that oftentimes they assume the Kingman coalescent, right? And we don't actually know whether the Kingman coalescent applies. So these are two limitations of these types of analyses. So we started thinking about, well, instead of actually using phylogenies, can we actually use kind of a simple population genetic summary statistic, you know, on sequences from specific time windows to do phylodynamic inference of SARS-CoV-2 and potentially other emerging pathogens that have very limited genetic diversity. Okay, so population genetics, summary statistics that of course comes to mind is Tajima's D, right? That many of you are probably familiar with. So Tajima's D is a difference between two different measures of genetic diversity, the mean number of pairwise differences, so kind of pi, and the number of segregating sites that is really kind of scaled so that in a neutrally evolving population that's of constant size, this difference would be expected to be zero. Okay, Tajima's D kind of was originally developed and is used heavily to kind of identify selection, right? Whether there's purifying selection going on or positive selection. But it also is impacted, its values are also impacted by population dynamics. So expanding populations are known to have negative Tajima's D values, and contracting or shrinking populations are known to have positive Tajima's D values. So we have been thinking about this, and of course we do a literature search just to make sure we're not reinventing the wheel. And we found this paper from a few years ago that was published in Epidemics, which actually also kind of introduced this Tajima's D statistics to effectively do phylodynamic inference using genetic data. It's been cited once, so I don't feel bad for not having known about this paper, but it's a really interesting paper. So if you're interested in this, I definitely encourage you to read it. To go into a little bit more detail with this paper, what they did was they used approximate Bayesian computation, so ABC, to estimate epidemiological model parameters. And they compared their results also to a birth-death skyline serial kind of model. They tested their approach on simulated data. And as you can see here, the true R naught from their simulated data here is around 1.5. And this is kind of their posterior distribution for the basic reproduction number and with the 95% credible intervals. And so this falls kind of within, you know, those credible intervals. They also applied it to pandemic H1N1 data. And what they came up with is an R naught estimate of about 1.55. with the credible intervals shown here, and they compared that to the birth-death skyline model, you know, which came up with these estimates, which are very similar, of course. The Zoom box keeps on popping up in various places that I don't want it to. and they were also, of course, able to kind of map out, you know, based on those R-naught values, what the effective reproduction number was over time. Okay, so we were interested in this approach. Again, they used kind of an approximate Bayesian computation approach, and they had other parts in their analysis which we think could be extended or improved upon. But what we first did was we actually wanted to get a better idea of how, you know, whether Tajima's D dynamics, whether there are signature in those dynamics that that would actually be visible, you know, even by eye, under different epidemiological dynamics and different model structures. So here you can see in the first column over here, if we simulate kind of an epidemiological SEIR model with two different R-naught values, 2.5 and 5, right, we get these two different dynamics in terms of the number of infecteds, right? And we also see very different dynamics in terms of Tajima's D. And this is the case kind of with, where you have the same amount of sampling at each time window of 4 days. So here with the higher R-naught, and a kind of more rapidly expanding population, right? Tajima's D falls negative, more negative, more quickly, right? This is a simulation where we compare SEIR dynamics without transmission heterogeneity to ones that have a substantial amount of transmission heterogeneity, where 10% of infected individuals cause 80% of secondary infections. And here is kind of the transmission heterogeneity simulation, and in black here, the no transmission heterogeneity simulation. And to compare them, you know, epidemiological dynamics are very similar because they're expected to be after the epidemiological dynamics kind of kick off, because transmission heterogeneity only adds effectively environmental noise once population sizes are large enough. So what we did was we kind of just shifted this over so that we would be able to more effectively compare Tajima's Z values. And what you can see is with more transmission heterogeneity, Tajima's D values are less negative. This makes sense because the number of segregating sites, so one of those components in that difference calculation, the number of segregating sites is smaller when you have transmission heterogeneity. So you're able to kind of see those differences kind of in these Tajima's D dynamics. And then the last thing we considered is actually just the extent of R0 changes after a specified date. So you can see here, this is where R0 is 2.5. during the whole epidemic. This is where R0 changes to 1.1 after that certain date. This is where R0 changes to 0.8 after that certain date. And what you can see here is that Tajima's D, to some extent, you know, although not extremely well, but to some extent can pick up these differences in changes in R0, especially when R0 becomes very low. Tajima's D doesn't kind of continue to decrease, but it kind of stabilizes a little bit. Okay, so we were happy with these results. We thought these were promising, that Tajima's D dynamics could change depending on these epidemiological model structures. We decided to, instead of using the Kim et al.'s ABC approach, we wanted to put that approach within a particle MCMC inference method. And so particle MCMC, some of you might be familiar with it already, it basically incorporates sequential Monte Carlo, it's also known as particle filtering, into MCMC. The underlying kind of modeling framework is oftentimes kind of a state space modeling framework. So you have a process model, which is basically the epidemiological dynamics, and also an observation model, which ties those state variables to kind of observations. And here, those observations are Tajima's D values. Particle MCMC is starting to be more heavily used by infectious disease modelers for interfacing epidemiological models with time series. There's this nice kind of paper from just last year looking at kind of incorporating particle MCMC or the benefits of using particle MCMC for infectious disease dynamics. And it allows for a very straightforward extension to combine both epidemiological case data and genetic data, where the genetic data are effectively incorporated via Tajima's D. Okay, so we wanted to test this out on simulated data first, the particle MCMC method. And so we just simulated an underlying SEIR type model. We simulated 660 sequences that were sampled, 30 sequences every 4-day interval. And this model was simulated with an R0 of 1.9, and just the starting time was just time zero. Right, and so here you can see the different epidemiological dynamics. Fraction susceptible, number exposed, number infected over time. And from those samples, we could calculate, you know, from those 660 samples, we could calculate Tajima's D over time. And you can see that the dynamics look like this over here. So these are the data that we then, simulated data that we then tried to recover from this particle MCMC Tajima's D approach. So again, I told you that this was preliminary work. So basically what we did first was instead of simulating kind of this MCMC chain, we basically just looked at the likelihoods that came out of the particle filtering kind of subroutine effectively. Where we specified an R0, you know, did the particle filtering component and then looked at and then plotted the likelihood based on that R0 for here. So here we have R0. The true R0 is 1.9, and this is the likelihood curve. And so you can see that, you know, particle MCMC, sorry, not particle MCMC, just the sequential Monte Carlo portion can give you kind of what we want, right? So peak and likelihood at the true R0. And what you see over here is, you know, a likelihood kind of surface based on looking at both R0 as well as the time of the start of the epidemic, so when we have one exposed individual in the population, using 200 particles, the true values are right here. So you can see that there's kind of this likelihood ridge over here. So there's high likelihoods also kind of associated with lower R0s with the pandemic starting a little bit earlier, right? Which makes sense. And so we do think that these results are promising, you know, especially if we have, you know, when we integrate this into the full particle MCMC, if we have priors, especially in terms of the when an epidemic or when a clade is introduced into a region, right, to kind of be able to kind of constrain the estimates a little bit more. So the next steps with this is that we're incorporating this into kind of a full particle MCMC routine. We're incorporating priors, and then we're going to go forward to do comparative analysis of SARS-CoV-2 data using different inferences approaches, both Eric Bolz's FIDINE as well as, you know, Tanya's birth-death skyline zero. Okay, so in the next 10 minutes or so, I want to go through a final project that we've been working on SARS-CoV-2, and that's identifying circulating recombinants, in the population. And this is work with Dave Van Insbergy, who's a postdoc who's joined between Anise Lowen's lab and mine, and Andy Nisch, and we're all at Emory. And if you're interested in this work, you can find it currently on BioArchive. It's currently, we're currently revising it. So just going back to this idea of super spreading and transmission heterogeneity, super spreading can be due to a number of different factors. So one factor is that some infected individuals can just be intrinsically more infectious, right? They might have higher viral load than others. So that might contribute to transmission heterogeneity. Some infected individuals might remain infectious for longer than others and therefore have more opportunity to spread, like typhoid Mary, like Mary Mellon. And then some infected individuals might have much higher contact rates than others, right? So if it's really kind of this last explanation, right, which is the predominant one in creating this transmission heterogeneity, right, then we expect co-infection rates to be potentially very high early on in the pandemic, as individuals who are becoming infected are those that have really the highest contact rates. So imagine this individual over here who has a very high contact rate. They might come across this individual who's infected, right? And that individual will give the virus to this focal individual, and that individual, because he has a high contact rate, might actually get exposed a second time, right? And then be co-infected, right? And so, of course, then when we have a co-infected individual, if that individual is transmitting only a small number of virions, then that individual can be transmitting a recombinant, right? And we know that recombination is possible in coronaviruses. We know this for the emergence of new pandemic lineages, you know, for SARS-CoV-2, SARS-CoV-1, et cetera. And also we know from seasonal coronaviruses that recombination also really occurs pretty frequently. So we're interested in actually looking at, you know, how common recombinants are in the population, because ultimately, you know, downstream, time-wise, viral recombination has the potential, right, to bring about new viral genotypes that have modified phenotypic characteristics, including those of transmissibility and virulence. And at the time that we were working on this, recombination had been mentioned in several SARS-CoV-2 studies and on several blogs, but there had not been a really focused analysis by that time. There is a really nice kind of paper right now on the preprint on BioArchive right now, which is a really nice paper and came out a little bit after kind of the one that we had posted on there. But they find very similar recombinants to the ones that we've identified, but they use a different approach. Okay, so what's the approach we use to actually identify recombinants? The approach we used was kind of this four-step approach. The first step was to characterize the mutations that define the clonal pattern of inheritance in SARS-CoV-2 clade structure. So I'll go into that first. Then we look at genomes from GISA that violate that pattern. Then what we can do is we can identify and refine the boundaries of those recombination sites by analyzing lower frequency SNPs that are shared by predicted parent sequences. And then what we do lastly is we assess the plausibility of the transfer by determining if the predicted parental clades were co-circulating in the country of infection. So I know that's kind of a lot here, but I'm going to go through each one of these in more detail on the next few slides. So the first step here, what Dave did here was he downloaded close to 10,000 high quality full genome sequences from GizAid. And these high quality full genome sequences were ones that actually had very few N's in them, right? And so this is a maximum likelihood tree from those those sequences. And what you can see are these clades that are very kind of visually apparent, right? And he's labeled them according to just the next strain clades. In some of these cases, there's more kind of resolution than we have from the next strain nomenclature, like 19B1 and -2. So we've kind of appended the next strain clades for that additional resolution. So he identified 13 clades, or maybe it was 14, I think it was 13 clades, and then looked at kind of which sites actually had what are known as clade-defining SNPs. He identified clade-defining SNPs. So these are positions where one clade at a specific site might be overwhelmingly a G, right? And at another, in the other clades or a subset of the other clades, it was predominantly A, more than 95% of the sequences. So what we have here in this plot are the different clades that were identified and the number of these clade-defining SNPs that differ between that pairwise combination of clades. So for example, 20B1 and 20B2, as you can see over here, these are these two clades, they differ by two clade-defining SNPs. So there's two sites in the genome where one of these one clade has, more than 95% of their sequences have one nucleotide and the other clade has less than 5% of that nucleotide. Okay. So he identified in all 37 clade defining SNPs. And you can see these right up here, organized kind of along the genome. So they really ranged from, site 241 to almost the very kind of end of the genome. So really spanned across the SARS-CoV-2 genome. And what you see over here as one of these rows are just the different clades that were identified and the nucleotides that were at each one of these clade defining SNPs. This one over here is kind of this famous D614G SNP. Okay, so given that, what we can then do is we then looked at these GizAid sequences that were available and we try to find recombinants that appear to violate those clonal patterns of inheritance. Right? And so what you see here at the top row is these are five putative recombinants that we identified, and these were kind of the strongest one of the bunch. Here we have the nucleotides at those clade-defining locations, at those sites. Here we have, again, kind of the clades that were identified from the maximum likelihood analysis. And when you see dots are sites that have the same nucleotide as the putative recombinant. And so what you can see here is that we see kind of this series of dots across 20C1 over here. And we see kind of these series of dots across 19B2, 19B3, right? And so so this could be, a recombinant between 20C1 and either 19B2 or 19B3, right? Because it's unlikely that this sequence came from, entirely belongs to 20C, right? Because we have this G, T, and T here, and it's unlikely that that sequence actually belonged to one of these two clades because you have all these other nucleotides, at these SNP defining locations. And so So we were able to kind of identify the putative kind of parental clades of these five different sequences. What we can then do is look more closely kind of within each one of those parental clades, right? And look at more minor genetic variation, more minor SNPs, so not these clade defining SNPs. And what you see here is you see the different, you know, recombinants that we've identified. Here's the bottom row in each one of these subpanels, and the sequence from each one of these kind of parental clades that actually seems to be genetically closest to the putative recombinant, right? And so the dark colored kind of diamonds here are the SNP defining clades. So you can see here that these SNP defining, clade defining SNPs. So these clade defining SNPs are, you know, for this part of the genome, match those in 20C, C1. And they also kind of match for this individual strain kind of that belongs to 20C1. The lighter red colored ones, right, are SNPs that are actually found in this recombinant, and they're also found in this parental strain, right? And then the light colored blue ones are the ones, these minor alleles that actually are found also in this kind of parental strain over here. So what this allows us to do is kind of refine the region of recombination, right, between these parental parental strains and the putative recombinants. Okay, so now that we've kind of refined that boundary, what we can do is we can basically infer phylogenetic trees from certain portions of the genome, right? And so again, we have the five different putative recombinants. If we infer a tree kind of using this part of the genome over here, right? This putative recombinant falls, you know, right here in this clade, right? But if we use the latter, half of the genome or latter, you know, third of the genome, that recombinant actually kind of falls here. So this really visualizes that, you know, the recombinant falls into two different clades, at, you know, at different parts of the genome, supporting it being a recombinant. And so we've done this for all five of them here. So you can see that those dots kind of change which clade they fall into. And finally, what we did was for these five different strains, we went back to kind of the their geographic location, and we looked at what was circulating there in the 2 weeks prior to that putative recombinants identification or sampling date. And what we found in all cases, but one, which is this one, but in the four other cases, what we found is that these parental clades that we inferred were actually circulating at high levels in the country. In the country of origin of that recombinant. The exception here is a very early sequence that was identified, kind of that was sampled in China. And here we only have kind of 45 sequences that were available for the 2 week time span kind of preceding the identification of that recombinant. And so that could just be kind of undersampling. Okay, so what I've shown you are kind of these five kind of gold, you know, or diamonds, right? Diamonds kind of in the sea of sequences, you know, so five recombinants in, you know, about 60,000 or so GISAID genomes or, at the time of our analysis. So what we did was we used very, very stringent cutoffs in terms of saying, well, what is a recombinant and what isn't? So basically we only allowed kind of a single breakpoint, right? So this is the maximum number of recombination breakpoints. So we only here allowed kind of a single breakpoint. And we had kind of a very stringent criteria for, what is a likely recombinant? So basically a likely recombinant had to be differ from its parental clade by at least three clade defining SNPs. And so here are the five that I showed right here, these very stringent requirements. But if we allow for more recombination breakpoints between parental clades. And we also kind of threshold for, you know, how many SNPs are required to actually say that this is recombinant. What we find is that we actually find many more recombinants in the GISAID data set. this is also not, you know, a huge number, you know, but what's interesting is that some of these recombinants that were identified under less stringent conditions seem to be circulating, so are not singletons in the data set, but seem to be circulating in the region. Okay, so what we're currently working on here is actually using this analysis in very heavily sampled areas like the UK, where you have the COG UK project. And what we can do is use kind of the number of identified recombinants kind of over time to work back kind of a ceiling on the extent of recombinant circulation given detection possibilities or given detection limitations. We're also looking at data on the SRA to look at patterns of SARS-CoV-2 co-infection. Okay, and with that, I'm just going to wrap up. So thank you all for listening. And I just want to acknowledge again all the collaborators on these projects who have been fantastic to work with. And I can take any questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Katia. A lot of virtual applause for you. And So some people already post questions, and whoever has other burning or questions, put them in the Q&A and I'll moderate that. So I'll pretty much ask Katia the questions. You can also up and down or upvote for questions which were already posted. And so maybe let me start with, there were quite a few questions on your middle part, namely okay. Where you used the TGMAD. And so one question a lot of people liked or had the same question was, if the RE dynamics, so if you don't only want to reconstruct the reproductive number, but the RE, can you also do that with TGMAD for time frames which are prior to the first sample of the sequence? So I understand if you don't have samples anymore and you have normally rely on really the tree branching points, does this still work?
Yeah, so that's a great question. And so what, if you have an underlying epidemiological, so the answer I think is yes. So if you have an underlying epidemiological model, right? Basically the population dynamics that are kind of reflected also kind of in the Tajima's D values then also tell you something about kind of what happened before that earlier sampling point. Because that epidemiological model structure kind of gives you some constraints. So for example, you know, if you estimate, you know, R naught, right, based on the Tajima's D values kind of later on in epidemic, right? If you estimate R naught and you have an idea of the initial number of susceptibles, you know, infection durations, et cetera, right? So you have kind of a fully kind of parameterized model then, right, which gives you predictions of what's happening to kind of RE, you know, and the number of susceptibles, you know, and so forth kind of before even the first time point of sampling.
Okay. Great, thank you. And then for the same project, people ask if you looked into summary statistics other than TGMAS-D to infer those dynamics.
Yeah, so we had been kind of looking around a little bit, you know, we've been thinking about things, and then we kind of, you know, thought of course kind of TGMAS-D given its, you know, given kind of what's known about it being, you know, changing according to, you know, or being affected by population dynamics. We are thinking about some other summary statistics effectively. So one thing we've been thinking about is actually using, and this is not well fleshed out yet, you know, but using, you know, the site frequency spectrum to that being kind of the, basically that distribution basically being the statistic, right? So we're thinking about that, but we have not formally incorporated that yet. But that would presumably also be able to be incorporated into one of these particle MCMC approaches.
Great, thank you. Let's now move to part one. Maybe I'll read out the question. It's long, okay. But I think. So in part one, you showed that the observed cumulative incidence in Israel fits the SEIR model's prediction best when setting the transmission heterogeneity parameter to 5%. So now the question, how confident can we be that the real transmission heterogeneity takes this approximate value? Could it be instead that accumulative incidence match shows up because of some partially inadequate assumptions in the model, which happen to be balanced out when setting the heterogeneity parameter to 5%.
Yeah, so that's a great question. So I think, you know, in part, you know, our estimates of things like, you know, that pH value, right, are based on, you know, other epidemiological parameter values that we either, you know, set, you know, based on epidemiological data, right, or, you know, have some kind of prior for some other, you know, for some of the other parameters. It does depend on these other parameters, right? And so if we find out, for example, that the duration of infection duration of the infectious period for SARS-CoV-2 is not, you know, 5.5, but instead we're like 9 or something like that, right? That could actually potentially change some of these predictions. And then I think kind of a bigger issue, right, is, you know, these are inferences drawn kind of under a particular, epidemiological model structure, you know, so this is an SEIIR model, right? But more generally, kind of, this is a coalescent based inference, right? And so, you know, there were some kind of tweets about this earlier in the week also, you know, about, well, you know, maybe the Kingman's coalescent, you know, we're assuming, you know, that being kind of an applicable coalescent process, right? But it might not be, right? And so, so I think some of these, you know, inferences, you know, depend in part on, you know, the overall kind of model structure that we assume, and we kind of oftentimes formulate that model structure based on what we think is going on. In kind of infectious disease ecology, where, you know, you have case data, you know, it's kind of common to, you know, say, okay, well, you know, we want to estimate parameters for this epidemiological model, but let's consider these alternative epidemiological models and actually let's do some model selection, right? And I know that's also kind of possible for phylodynamics. There's a paper that Dave Rasmussen, who used to be my group, kind of spearheaded a few years ago, like 10 years ago now. So you can do model selection, you know, based on phylodynamic, sequence data. But I think it's not done often enough, right? And so both with respect to epidemiological model structure and then kind of even the coalescent, underlying coalescent process assumed. I think we're always kind of doing the best we can, but I think, you know, some of the results ultimately kind of, you know, have to be kind of revisited, you know, based on new information and revisions to kind of what our underlying assumption is of kind of, you know, the epidemiological process. That said, you know, this 5%, 5% of cases, 5% of the most infectious individuals being responsible for 80% of the secondary infections, that's actually been, you know, that seems to actually agree with a few other analyses, which are more epidemiological analyses. So I don't think it's kind of out of the ballpark, but I think it adds to the bulk of kind of, you know, empirical kind of data and evidence and research findings that there's a huge amount of transmission heterogeneity for SARS-CoV-2.
Great, thank you. For this third project, there was a question, how do you differentiate between a recombinant and multiple different viruses co-occurring in one patient?
Yeah, and so the way you can do this is by actually going to the deep sequencing data. So Dave's actually done this, where you know, the data are actually on the short read archive, you know, are available on short read archive, and he's also kind of emailed the labs, you know, that have actually posted, you know, or contributed to GISAID, you know, these recombinant sequences, what we think are recombinant sequences. And so what you can do is you can kind of look at the deep sequencing data to kind of confirm that. And the other paper I mentioned, that's on BioArchive, that uses a different approach for identifying recombinants. They also kind of looked under the hood a little bit at some of those where available. I would definitely encourage people who are submitting to GISAID to actually also make their deep sequencing data available, publicly available, because it is useful for these types of analyses.
Great. Thank you. So scanning through their questions, there are also some more general questions. So one person is wondering whether the proposed method for investigating phylodynamics can be used also in phylogeography. So I guess referring to the second part on the phylodynamics.
Again, I haven't thought about this kind of in huge amount of detail, but one thing I was thinking about, in the last like a couple of days was, you know, so we have this pretty high profile analysis from Trevor Bedford's group, kind of looking at Washington 1, right, and then looking at Washington 2, right, and this inference of there being cryptic transmission for many weeks, right, and then there was, following up on that nice analysis, there was a really nice analysis also by Mike Warby and collaborators of his that came out that was arguing, that first sequence, Washington 1, you know, there was actually kind of a stop to that transmission chain, and it was actually a reintroduction, from the outside, right? And so as part of that paper, they simulated some transmission models effectively to actually show that it was very unlikely that that sequences sampled, weeks later, effectively would be so genetically similar if there had been cryptic transmission for many, many weeks, right? And so effectively, Tajima's D would kind of capture that as well, right? So Tajima's D, if you have very few sequences, but they're all very genetically the same, genetically very similar, weeks in, you have a very small number of segregating sites, right? And you have also a very small kind of pairwise genetic diversity. And so you would have Tajima's D very close to zero, right? But if it had actually been cryptically circulating for a very long period for those weeks, you would see many more, much higher number of segregating sites you would expect, which would bring Tajima's D, to more negative values. Pairwise genetic diversity would still be relatively low. So I think Tajima's D could actually, be used kind of to determine whether, maybe in the absence of, additional, data from worldwide samples, whether there is kind of sustained transmission, in a clade, or whether there seems to be kind of these multiple introductions.
Okay, and a final question, very important for everyone, are asymptomatic individuals infectious?
So I don't think that's necessarily a question for me, but so are asymptomatic individuals infectious? Probably, yeah. So there's kind of this distinction between asymptomatic and pre-symptomatic, right? It's definitely thought that individuals can be very, very highly infectious before they actually develop symptoms, right? But there are also cases that, read about more in, New York Times, et cetera, where it seems like there are these, instances of kind of people who just remain asymptomatic even the whole time, and that there are these clear cases that they have actually transmitted to family members, et cetera. So I think it's, it's not really a question of kind of like, is it feasible in this world that there is someone who's asymptomatic that actually transmits, but how important is that, as a contributing factor, relative to pre-symptomatic individuals? Effectively, pre-symptomatic and asymptomatic are also not, basically the person doesn't have symptoms, right? And so if someone doesn't know that they're, if they don't have symptoms, they don't know whether they're pre-symptomatic or asymptomatic, right? A certain point in time. And so there's definitely, a huge role for actually, wearing masks, and making sure, testing, et cetera. So.
And yeah, maybe if I may add there, because I guess maybe this question comes also from a bit of a Swiss background here in the media, really asymptomatic and pre-symptomatic is very often mixed up. And yeah, most people are first, pre-symptomatic, they are infectious. We know that. But that doesn't mean they're asymptomatic throughout the whole infection. And sometimes people use asymptomatic instead of pre-symptomatic. So you're definitely, if you caught it after 3 days or so, you are most likely infectious. And only after 5 days you show symptoms. So what Katia said, be careful because you never know if you transmit is definitely evidence-based statement.
Right, absolutely.
With that, thank you so much, Katia, for this great talk. And this was fantastic. Thank you very much for joining the whole session. And yeah, we are very happy that despite all those other things going on with SARS-CoV-2, you took the time to talk to us about your work.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for the invitation.
Okay, I think I have the pleasure to take over now. I hope you agree, Tanja. So thank you, Katia, also from my side for the great presentation. That was really, really wonderful. I have the pleasure to chair the next two presentations now. And in fact, those will be given by Tanja Stadler and then by Sarah Nadeau afterwards. So Tanja will talk next. Most of you know her very well, of course. She's a professor in our Department of Biosystems Science and Engineering. She heads the Computational Evolution Group, develops phylogenetic methods over a wide range, including many applications, medical applications, and of course, epidemiological applications. And she will talk about some of her insights regarding the Swiss SARS-CoV-2 epidemic.
Thank you very much, Niko, for the introduction. So indeed, I will talk about quantifying the key epidemiological quantities of COVID-19, looking mostly at genome data. And we'll first talk about more the global view and then zoom into the Swiss view. And then after me, Sarah will actually zoom in much, much greater detail on top on the Swiss view. So first I'll talk to you about what happened prior to lockdown, so around the world, so how things started in Wuhan and the initial global spread, followed by zooming into during and after lockdowns with the example of Switzerland. So there was a fully healthy population, a first individual in late 2019 in presumably Wuhan got infected with SARS-CoV-2 and developed COVID-19. And then assumed this person infected two other people, and those two people again infect two people, and so on. So as you already see from those numbers, then the epidemic is spreading quite fast. And in fact, all what I did here was illustrating this key epidemiological quantity, this basic reproductive number, which also came up in Katia's talk, which is the average number of secondary infections caused by a first infected individual. Why am I highlighting this? This was a big unknown at the time COVID-19 started spreading in Wuhan. But it's super important to know what it is because it tells us how many people will eventually be infected with the disease before actually we have the so-called herd immunity and not enough susceptible individuals that the virus spreads further. And under very simple, admittedly simple models, but in a rough rule of thumb, if the herd immunity will be reached once more than one minus one divided by R naught, people will be infected with the disease. And so among others, here I picked the study from Julia Rioux and Christian Althaus, who are in Bern, epidemiologists. They looked at confirmed case data, which we got from Wuhan. So how many people were newly confirmed each day? And so then knowing that roughly every 5 days, this is the generation time, we on average infect the next people. If, you know, one day we had 10 infected individuals, 5 days, there are 20 confirmed cases. That means those 10 people give rise to 20 additional infections. And based on kind of such considerations, they estimated in a Bayesian approach this basic reproductive number to be somewhere around 2, with admittedly quite a large uncertainty interval. But it gave a very early warning because that's quite high. So seasonal influenza would be 1.1, 1.3, if it's a bad season, 1.4, but definitely way below 2. And on top, as we all know, came that the infection fatality rate is quite high. So we were then wondering what was actually the basic reproductive number in other parts of the world? Because, I mean, there was still hope. Maybe Wuhan has certain characteristics which make it easy for the virus, but it won't be so bad for the rest of us. So then you don't have a problem, though, when you look at other places with the same approaches Ryu and Al used. Namely, in a particular country, early case numbers may be either local transmissions or, as Katia showed, for example, in the Israel study, a lot of introductions from abroad. There it was the US. And unless we really can pinpoint down and thus take into account how many introductions we have, and typically in most of our countries, contact tracing broke down pretty much after the virus arrived. We have no idea how many introductions there were. So we may bias any R naught estimates upward because we assume introductions are actually local transmissions. And this is now where SARS-CoV-2 sequencing data comes in. It allows us to reconstruct actually local transmission clusters, which then in turn allow us to quantify R naught using so-called phylodynamic tools. And this is exactly what we set out to do. First though, give me, I'll show you on this one slide what the rationale behind that is. So we have the initial sequence, say this, just the SARS-CoV-2, assume it only had 8 digits. Then there was a transmission event. This pathogen was transmitted to another person, etc. And then occasionally there are mutations, and on site 7, the T changed to a C, etc. Now, if two people are close in the transmission chain, they actually have more similar genomes because there was less time for evolution. And what phylogenetics is now doing, we look at those sequences. So from different infected individuals, we sequence the genomes, and based on similarity, we reconstruct the transmission chain. And we did that early on for all the sequences which were available at the time on GIS-8. And here I show you a subtree of that. And what you can take away from that already in red, you see from the Hubei province, where also Wuhan is, sequences and also reconstructed internal locations. And then slowly but surely it spread to Europe. Green is now Italy, blue, for example, is France. So here you see displayed a reconstruction from a transmission chain. And now what we did was we selected different outbreaks from this huge tree to quantify this basic reproductive number for the particular outbreak slash country. So for example, you could envision we chose all those blue dots from France and estimated the French reproductive number. And so Katia talked a lot about how one can use coalescence theory for quantifying the reproductive number and other epidemiological quantities. And what we here did was more using a burst test type model. And it's inspired to some extent from classic epidemiology. So there we have those so-called SIR models, susceptibles, infecteds, and recovereds. Infected individuals have some rate, say lambda, to infect others, and some rate mu to become uninfectious. And so now you can just envision, you simulate, you have an initial individual, you have branching times, transmission events, giving rise to new individuals, and sometimes individuals recover, which would be here the red cross. And now what is really important, and that's how it differs from the more classic epi modeling, we have some sampling probability. With that probability, we actually take the sample from the patient and sequence their genome. And now the orange bubbles are those individuals of whom we sequence the genome. Now we take the sequences, as I showed you on the last slides, and reconstruct this tree connecting our sampled individuals. Okay, but now you wonder, what are we actually doing to get the R naught? Well, what we now do or did over the past years is, under this model, we want to write down the probability of such a reconstructed tree, given those parameters, transmission, become uninfectious, sampling, when the outbreak started, T naught. And then the basic reproductive number is simply the transmission rate divided by the become uninfectious rate. And once we have this probability written down, we can do maximum likelihood or Bayesian methods to quantify those parameters. And why it's a challenge to write it down is that a lot of cases we didn't sequence. So we have an immense incomplete data set, and through the calculation of this probability, we need to take into account that we have hidden individuals, which in the calculation we do with some differential equation approaches. Due to time limitations, I can't go into how we exactly do it, but rather would like to now show you what the results are when we apply that. So we quantify this lambda, this mu, and I told you the ratio would be the reproductive number. And so you here see on the right-hand side, for if we do that for China, Italy, Washington, Washington State, and the US, we roughly get the same reproductive numbers to be 2.5 with, you know, confidence intervals or uncertainty intervals between 2 and 4 on a cruise ship, which you might have all read in the media, the Diamond Princess. It was a bit higher, which is not surprising. It's a very dense contained environment. Meaning it told us that in we would expect that pretty much in any countries we have rapid spread. Already those first three regions had a high reproductive number. Then later on, we did it across more countries and outbreaks. By then, admittedly, we already knew it's spreading quite fast. And again, we see for most regions around two or some even higher. So from that, we then knew the spread across the world will unfortunately be similar to the initial spread in Wuhan, unless we implement interventions. And now to go beyond just the reproductive number, what else did we learn by analyzing those outbreaks? Actually, what I showed you is in those burst death models, you have this parameter, the sampling probability. And pretty much once you know what fraction of samples are actually have you taken, you can calculate essentially back what is the overall number of infections through time. And so Tim Wan developed a few years ago already an approach involving so-called particle filtering, what also Katia talked about, to actually quantify back in time the number of infections. And what you now see here as the median, as the orange line, and then in red, the uncertainty intervals, is the number of infections cumulative through time, which we estimate for Washington State and the US. And so what you see from here, at some stage, late January, early February, but with quite a bit of uncertainty around that date, this outbreak seemed to have started. And now have a look at what the confirmed case data tell us. So how, what they did through PCR testing, what they confirmed was for a long time, there was this one initial case, which Katia also talked about. And only by late February, they confirmed a lot of cases. And it seems then by March, surveillance was actually pretty good. And they catched a lot of cases based on our estimates. It seems like in most cases, we don't estimate more infections compared to what they predict. But here in mid-February, there must have been a lot of cryptic transmission. So genomes can then tell you what was the number of infected people through time. And I should say here for completeness, and that was also mentioned by Katia, Trevor Bedford did amazing. So he also collected this genome data and he did also amazing studies on essentially verifying and showing there was cryptic transmission and things were not optimal with surveillance. So with this, I now wanna go into Switzerland and more look what happened after those initial outbreaks. And so this other important concept is this effective reproductive number, which is the secondary number of infections caused by a single individual at some time point, not necessarily at the start of the outbreak. And what we do now here a bit in the Ryu et al. Sense, we estimate the reproductive numbers through time for Switzerland. And as you see, it went below one after the lockdown with the opening of the country in mid-May, it went higher, was above, slightly above one for most of the summer. And now, unfortunately, as all people, at least from our department, probably know, case numbers are increasing incredibly fast. And so if you're keen to look at, you know, your favorite countries, et cetera, we provide here in a shiny app for all different countries, the estimates for the reproductive number. You can also look at a map, how the different regions are doing. So I encourage you to play around rather than me telling you now about 10 countries what's happening. You can look yourself what interests you. Let me though say that imports and exports of infections may actually bias those reproductive number estimates. Because, you know, if we have a lot of imports, actually we again confound local transmission with import status. And so this brings me to the final point I wanted to talk to you about, that we looked or aimed at quantifying the reproductive numbers through time based on SARS-CoV-2 genomes from Switzerland. Here now, actually, Sarah after me will tell you a lot about this particular data set. For me, just let me show you that using we sequenced 1,500 sequences, we estimated the reproductive number based on sequences here shown in yellow. And on top, I put in red the RE based on confirmed cases. And what we can see is early on during the end of lockdown, we are below one. And then based on sequences, our uncertainty is just bigger. It's kind of containing the intervals of confirmed cases, but uncertainty is bigger. So it seems at least there's not a huge bias that, or the sequences don't tell us that we do majorly wrong with the confirmed case data. A different aspect to look at this data is also again, coming back to the sampling proportion, you can estimate how many people we missed out of all infections. This was this row parameter. And this would be the yellow estimate. So it would be, you know, what proportion did we sample out of all infections? It went up to 10%. And what we estimate. And now you can plot that against the fraction of sequences out of the confirmed cases. And since the confirmed cases are lower bound for all the number of individuals, the red curve is a bit below the yellow curve, or if we do really bad in catching cases, it would be a lot below the yellow curve. But as you see here, actually based on our estimates, it seems that we are quite well capturing right now with the testing regime until probably 2 weeks ago, the epidemic status within Switzerland. And again, importantly here, the genomes again take into account the import and export across countries because we look for those individual transmission clusters. With this, I just want to summarize that confirmed case data again provides great estimates of the effective reproductive number. Contact tracing allows us to connect confirmed case data, but then the genomes actually are those is a great data source to connect then transmission couples where we have which we can't trace back because say contact tracing ends at national borders and so on. So by looking at those genomes and the trees, we can get a more complete picture of the overall past epidemic. With this, I want to thank the different parties involved. First, the Computational Evolution Group, different members put great effort in all the different SARS-CoV-2 analyses. Our collaborators, both from ETH as well as from Niko Beerenwinkel's group, helping with the bioinformatics. The NextGen team from the Biozentrum here in Basel. Then the different members of the Swiss National COVID-19 Science Task Force, with whom we regularly exchange. The genomic facility Basel sequenced all those Swiss genomes, and the Violier AG, a diagnostic company of whom you might get bills regularly. They actually provided for free all the samples, and SNF for funding. And now, I'm happy to then pass it on to Sarah, but take questions after the next talk. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Tanja. Yeah, we continue with Sarah and we take questions after that. So maybe you can stop sharing your screen. Thanks, Tanja. So Sarah is a PhD student in Tanja's group. I think she joined the department only last year and already has produced some very interesting results that she will share with us.
All right, great. Can you see the correct screen view?
No, we see your presenter's mode.
Again.
If you can switch it somehow.
Perfect. How's that?
Yeah, that's good.
Excellent. Okay. So as Tanja mentioned, I will share some of the results of our Swiss-wide SARS-CoV-2 sequencing project, here focusing on a few tree-based estimates of SARS-CoV-2 in Switzerland. To give a bit of background on this project, as Tanja mentioned, the diagnostics company Villiers provided viral RNA extracts from Swiss individuals who tested positive for a SARS-CoV-2 infection. And they've provided now thousands of viral extracts, and Christian in the genomics facility has sequenced just about 1,500 of these by now. And these samples span the duration of the epidemic since early March until, in this analysis, I'll present results up until the end of summer in August. And what I show in this left-hand plot are these green bars is the fraction of all laboratory confirmed cases that we have SARS-CoV-2 genome sequences for. So week to week, our data set includes about 3 to 7% of all laboratory confirmed cases through time. And in the right-hand plot, I show that these cases come from all over Switzerland. And with this very rich data set, we can ask many, many questions about the evolution and epidemiological dynamics here in Switzerland. For this flash talk, I'll just focus on three questions, namely, when did introductions of SARS-CoV-2 into Switzerland occur? Where did they come from? And how important are these introductions compared to local transmission in Switzerland to driving the Swiss epidemic through time? I think we've all seen a lot of tree pictures by now, but where I'll step in is based on, let's say we have a reconstructed phylogenetic tree containing viruses from Swiss cases, and then maybe in this toy example, also some German cases. I would like to identify in the tree which cases are from locally generated Swiss transmission chains. To do that, we use an estimation procedure in which we assume that viruses sampled from Swiss cases, which are more similar to one another than global diversity, are likely the result of local transmission. And that each of these clades of similar Swiss viruses arises from a separate lineage introduced into Switzerland through time. And those would be indicated by these orange slashes. So once I've defined Swiss transmission chains, in this case, one transmission chain of two cases and one of one sampled case, I'd like to start answering some of these questions, namely, when did these introductions occur through time? Looking at the tree, the point at which a transmission chain attaches to the rest of the tree can be taken as an estimate of the time of the last transmission event for this viral lineage outside of Switzerland. On the other hand, the most recent common ancestor of the sequences within a Swiss transmission chain would be an estimate for the first transmission in Switzerland, or the first local transmission. And the time of introduction could be plausibly any time between these two events. So what we've done is we've tallied the timing of these two events across all the transmission chains we infer from these 1,400 different Swiss sequences. And on the top plot, I show that lower bound estimate of the import date. And in the bottom plot, we have the upper bound or more recent estimate. And this dashed line is the date of the Swiss lockdown and partial border closures, so implemented on March 17th. And what I take away is that many fewer introductions occurred in the week just after lockdown compared to the weeks just before, which is exactly what we would expect and was the goal of this public health intervention. Next, we wanted to ask, where did introductions come from? And we can do this by again comparing Swiss sequences on the tree with foreign sequences. In this case, we tried to be very careful to sample foreign sequences proportional to the number of imports we think happen into Switzerland. In this case, if the UK happens to sequence much more than Germany, we don't want to include way more UK sequences in our tree because it will bias our estimates. But in this toy example, we can see that one of our Swiss transmission chains clusters next to a clade of German sequences. So in this case, we would estimate that this transmission chain was introduced from Germany. However, further back in the tree, we become less certain about whether lineages were circulating in Italy or in Germany. So for this introduction, further back in the tree, we would assign it a probability 1/2 of having been introduced from Italy and 1/2 from Germany. In this next plot, I tally the frequencies of different countries as they're estimated to be the origin locations of different Swiss transmission chains. And focusing on the early epidemic here from February with the first cases until April, we can see that we infer many introductions to come from our neighboring countries, Italy, Germany, and France, with quite some noise in these estimates. However, over the summer, we notice that Belgium and the Netherlands pop up more often as the source location of Swiss transmission chains. And more recently, we have a strong signal for introductions coming from the neighboring countries, France and Germany. As a final question, we wanted to ask how important introductions were in driving the Swiss epidemic compared to local transmissions. For this, we designate an introduction index case, which is the first sequence we catch from each transmission chain. We assume this is an estimate for the actual introduction case. Subsequent cases in a transmission chain, we assume result from local transmission. And we can tally the number of these introduction index cases versus local transmission cases through time. So again, based on our tree of 1400 Swiss sequences, we present upper and lower bounds, which are two different cluster definitions. And at the start of the epidemic, we're very uncertain which percentage of cases arise from local transmission, simply because there's low viral diversity and we're not able to state confidently how large transmission chains are. However, into the summer months, we note that the probability a case arises from a local transmission increases compared to the probability it's coming from an import. And more recently, we see an increase in the significance of introductions again. Lastly, this result has implications for contact tracing because we cannot prevent transmissions that occur before an introduction index case has been confirmed. After this point, perfect contact tracing could potentially stop ongoing transmission. So here we tally the number of cases that we just cannot prevent because we have not even identified the introduction index case yet. So those would be the pink portions of these bars. On the other hand, samples from transmission chains that occur further after we've already identified the introduction index case could potentially be prevented under an ideal contact tracing scenario. And the point I'll highlight here is that during the summer months, contact tracing has a huge potential to reduce overall case numbers. After this really brief flash talk, I'd like to thank in particular Villiers again and our counterparts in this CBG group for their help in the bioinformatics end of this project, and then also the SIVO group for their very helpful discussions. And I'll point to the fact that as the epidemic progresses, we will plan to keep updating these results and hopefully even extend them with the inclusion of more patient metadata. And when these results are available, we will also put them on the Swiss National Scientific Task Force website. So now I believe Tanja and I will take questions on both of our presentations as they cover sort of extensions of the same projects.
Thank you very much, Sarah and Tanja, for your nice presentations. Wonderful. So if you have questions, please post them now. I cannot see any question right now, unless I'm doing something wrong here, then please tell me what to do. But of course, I will take the chance to ask a question first. So I don't know, probably to Sarah, you did this analysis on the level of countries, and I'm wondering whether you could do it on other sort of spatial scales, like between cantons, for example, within Switzerland, or maybe even the higher spatial resolution. My first question is, can this be done at all? And the second is maybe how useful might it be in terms of designing interventions? People start talking about closing borders again in Europe. Is that useful at all? Or should we close borders between cantons instead? Would you be able to comment on that? Would your model be able to tell us something about it?
Mm-hmm. To answer the first part of your question, we could apply the exact same origin location estimation procedure at different geographic levels. Of course, at the country level has enormous political consequences, as you've pointed out. And at the cantonal level, I agree it would be particularly interesting, for example, to identify whether perhaps cantons in the central Switzerland are seeded, infections there are seeded from perhaps cantons that are more globally connected, for example, Basel. To answer the second part of your question, sort of, what implications do these analyses have? I think the results can be read in several different ways. We could say, yes, we definitely need to close borders because it's very hard for Swiss contact tracing to identify new introductions compared to a local transmission chain. Because again, as Tanja mentioned, contact tracing ends at the Swiss borders. One other reading could be, actually, let's continue with mandatory quarantining rather than closing borders entirely. So there's clearly, I think we can be creative in the policies we develop to quell new introductions. And I don't want to make a statement about which one is my favorite. I would simply say that there's great promise in beefing up our contact tracing capabilities, and that introductions are perhaps relatively more difficult to contain.
Okay, thank you. We have a few questions arriving. Let me try to pick one or two of them. What type of data would you need to refine your estimates? Just more sequences or particular sequences, earlier sequences? Can you comment on that? Either one of you have to find out.
I'll just throw in one quick point, and maybe Tanja has additional thoughts. But it's rather impossible, but a more diverse early epidemic would have allowed us more precise estimates. However, a faster evolving virus may not be ideal for other reasons. Beyond that, it's quite helpful to have deep sequencing coverage from countries with lots of travel connections to Switzerland.
Maybe if I may, at the one point, I think what we are now trying really hard is to actually get for the sequences metadata, clinical information, etc. And that's being done around the globe. People try to have that. Obviously, there are ethical constraints, etc. But that will help us a lot knowing our clusters in the same age groups, what is the clinical outcomes, to early see if some clusters actually say evolve to different clinical outcomes. So far, we don't see signs there, but I think this metadata might be useful.
Okay, great. One more question maybe. When you assemble the genomes, what coverage do you expect? So the question here is about that the consensus sequence may look different and that may affect the downstream analysis. Do you discard samples with low coverage? Do you find some ways around it? Can you briefly comment on that?
Sure. We try to be conservative-ish. So we only make a base call for positions that have coverage of five times or higher. And if these five or more reads are inconsistent in the base they sort of predict for a site, then we'll use an ambiguity code. Other than that, I would say we also reject sequences where we don't have at least two-thirds of the genome with adequate coverage. And we still are able to retain ballpark 60% of the samples from Villiers. And so far this has been enough sequences that it challenges the tree building methods. So I would say that we're not particularly data poor.
Okay, thanks again to both of you. And I think we leave it here and we will try to answer the remaining questions in writing. Thank you.
Good. Then I'll take over the microphone again, at least for two sentences, namely that I'm very happy now to introduce Niko Beerenwinkel, who most of you know here in the department. I hope all of you know. And so they actually, their group helped us for our part with the bioinformatics, but obviously had research questions on their own using this sequencing data from Viollier. So please, Niko, the floor, the Zoom is yours.
Thanks. My PDF didn't work again, but since that happened before when we tried it out already, I should know what to do. Let me try again. Okay. So that's actually good. I'm just trying the full screen mode. Okay, that I think does the trick, right? Okay, so I briefly want to talk about VPipe, which is a piece of software that has been developed in my group, and it aims at estimating the diversity within a virus population. So we are very interested in the diversity of RNA viruses that they display within a single infected host. And SARS-CoV-2 is one example of such viruses, but there's a whole range, of course, of RNA viruses. Several of them are medically very relevant, including HIV, HCV, and several others. And so the diversity within these hosts has been associated with a number of clinical outcomes like disease progression, drug resistance development, immune escape, and so on. So there is a lot of interest on the one hand side in intra-host genetic diversity from a medical perspective. And on the other hand, as I think became clear today already, also from an evolutionary perspective, of course, it can reveal many aspects of the infection dynamics, also about transmission events and transmission chains. It can also help detecting selective pressure within viral genomes and so on. Of course, traditionally, viral genomes have been analyzed by Sanger sequencing, and they essentially give you only the consensus sequence of a virus. And with the arrival of what we call next generation sequencing, today there is really an opportunity to probe these populations in much more detail and to assess and to sample the diversity within a single patient and within one virus population. Now, with the data that you obtain from such a mixed sample come a lot of challenges in the data analysis, and I want to mention three major challenges here. The first one is the uncertainty that's associated with mapping the reads. So when you have a reference genome, in the first step, you would like to map the reads to the reference genome. And you know, while just localizing the read on the genome is not so difficult, it is difficult to produce a high quality multiple sequence alignment of all the reads. And if you base the assessment of diversity in the population on your alignment, then any mistake that you make in the alignment will propagate and will affect your estimates of diversity. So that is a challenge. Then there is a number of confounding factors in the analysis, and the main ones are amplification and sequencing errors. So there's a lot of things you have to do with your sample before you get to the sequencing data, which is confounding. And finally, you're often interested in a genomic region that's simply larger, longer than the read length, especially if you use short read technologies like Illumina sequencing. So there's an assembly problem here, and that's in general difficult to solve. So I will not talk about the third one here, but I will briefly touch upon the first two challenges. So our tool is called vPipe, which is really a pipeline. So it's a combination of different tools that we put together. And really the starting point for this was to create something that allows you to do reproducible analysis. Overall, these analyses are very subtle in the sense that different parameters can give you quite different results, and we wanted to create a framework that allows a reproducible, transparent, and also traceable analysis of your samples. Of course, things have to be robust and not too slow, and we wanted an approach that's modular and of course relatively easy to use. So you start with your read data obtained from a virus population, and the pipeline does several steps on a very high level. They include quality control measures, the read mapping or read alignment step, and then the assessment of diversity, for example, in the form of single nucleotide variants. So if we zoom a bit further into this, the reads are delivered in FASTQ format. And if you have a reference genome, you will provide that as input, of course. And the output contains, of course, the consensus sequence of your sample. And that's, in fact, the object Sarah has used in her analysis. But in addition, what we're trying to do here is to call any low frequency variants in the population. And sometimes we're even interested in doing assembly of all the low frequency haplotypes, so the low frequency strains within the population. So the output for a single sample is illustrated here. This is in fact a SARS-CoV-2 sample, and shown in this gray background is the coverage, the sequencing coverage obtained for this particular sample. And these lollipops correspond to single nucleotide variants, so differences with respect to the reference sequence. And you see that some of them are clonal essentially. So the whole population has a difference here, including the famous D614G that made its appearance already today. But then there's a number of mutations at frequencies maybe around 60 or 40%. And then there's a large number of variants down here at very low frequencies. And these are, of course, particularly difficult to detect, or let's say to detect reliably, because you're getting closer here to the error rate of your sequencing process. So I want to highlight two aspects that we worked on quite a bit, namely the alignment of the reads and the calling of the SNVs. So for the alignment, we are trying to generate a high quality multiple alignment of the reads. And essentially what we would like to estimate is a profile hidden Markov model to do that alignment. That's a standard tool to create such multiple sequence alignments, but it's very difficult to estimate the parameters of this model for a large number of reads as you typically obtain from NGS experiments. So the way we do this here is we start by building local multiple sequence alignments, usually by subsampling the reads, and we use these local blocks to estimate local parameters of the profile HMM. And then finally, we remap or we realign all the reads to the profile HMM, and that eventually gives us a full multiple sequence alignment of the reads. And we compare here the quality of these alignments with our tool called NGS HMM Align to two standard read mappers, Bowtie 2 and BWA. And I will not go into the details of the simulation of these data, how we assess this, but overall, you see an improvement, of course. That comes at the cost of increased computation time, but it gives you an improved way of improved starting point, I should say, for calling variants in these samples. The second aspect is the calling of SNVs themselves, or of estimating diversity in more general terms. So this can be done on different spatial scales on the genome, starting from SNVs. So if you just look at a single column of this alignment, then in this particular example, for example, you would like to find out that the T that you observed here in the middle in red is actually an error and is not a real variation within the population, whereas all the other characters observed here, including the C, for example, that occurs only twice, is a real variant. So the name of the game here is to distinguish sequencing error from true biological variants. And you can try to do that in each column of the alignment independently and separately. You can also try to do this in local windows over the alignment, such that these windows are covered by a number of reads. Or you can try to do it globally, and then you're in the setting of an assembly problem. You have to put together local evidence in order to generate global haplotypes. So I'm interested here only in SNVs for the purpose of this talk. I will not talk about the global problem, but I want to convince you quickly that in order to call SNVs, it's actually a good idea to look at the local reconstruction problem. And the basic argument is very simple. So if you think about it, without doing anything extremely clever or sophisticated, it's somehow intuitively clear that at a single position, the error rate denoted here by epsilon has to be smaller than the frequency of the SNV you want to detect in order for you to have a chance to get it right. If the error rate is higher, there's no way basically to do that at a single position. However, if you look at two positions that you, and you can observe their co-occurrence within the length of a single read, then in fact, the condition becomes that epsilon squared, the square of the error rate, has to be smaller than the frequency of the SNV. And if you do it for triplets, it's the error rate to the power of 3 and so on. So in other words, the more sites you can analyze at the same time and you can compare simultaneously, the higher an error rate you can afford to estimate the same low frequency variant, or put differently, for the same error rate, you can estimate SNVs at lower frequencies than the error rate. So this is shown on this figure here. And this basically means you should try to analyze as many SNVs at the same time as you can. And what this means for us is that we're doing the local reconstruction problem. We're trying to find variants not individually at each column of the alignment, but rather in these windows that are covered by still a large number of reads. And what does it mean to find variants here? Well, it basically means to cluster these local haplotypes, so to group them together in such a way that for each cluster, all the sequences are most likely derived from the same true haplotype in the population. So if you cluster them successfully, then, for example, the consensus sequence of the cluster is your predicted local haplotype. And from this, you can derive the frequency, the relative cluster size, and of course, the SNVs that have occurred in this cluster relative to the reference sequence. This approach, again, performs better than a state-of-the-art method that looks at each column individually. The clustering itself, of course, is a hard problem, and we're using here a non-parametric Bayesian approach to do that. It's, again, computationally more demanding than running a simple tests on each column, but it gives you higher quality SNV calls. And just to show you, to wrap up and to show you one example, this is a particular HIV data set from the P17 gene. And these are longitudinal samples from a single patient. The different time points are the different colors. And the sequence space here, this is just a mapping into two dimensions to visualize sequence space. And the size of each dot here is the estimated abundance of that particular haplotype. And the disks surrounded by this black circle here are in fact low frequency variants that have not been reported in the original study, but that we were able to identify using this approach. Okay, with that, I would already like to wrap up. So this pipeline called VPipe provides a robust computational framework for reproducible analysis of viral and next generation sequencing data. We want, of course, to support any research efforts that make use of intra-host diversity, but also clinical diagnostics where low frequency variants can play an important role. The pipeline has also modules for testing and benchmarking that I didn't show you, but the results I showed you are based on this. The pipeline is actively maintained. It's open source and community driven. So we really want to provide here a framework that allows comparable, reproducible analysis across labs and so on. Here's the website where you can access the code, including documentation, tutorials, and so on. There is a bioarchive preprint so far describing the pipeline, and we have, of course, already applied it to a number of different viruses, including SARS-CoV-2. And in fact, Jack, who will talk right after me, will present you an analysis using VPipe to SARS-CoV-2 data. I would briefly like to thank people in my group, especially Susanna Posada. She was a PhD student in my group, graduated quite recently. She developed a lot of VPipe. Ivan Topolsky is a software engineer in my lab who maintains VPipe and runs it on a regular basis. Kim Philip Jablonski was also involved in further developing VPipe. With that, thank you for your attention, and I will hand over to Jack.
Thank you, Niko. And yes, indeed, now Jack Kuipers, a senior scientist in Niko's group, will do the second part of this presentation. And then please just put any questions you have for Niko or Jack, as before, into the Q&A boxes. And just for your information, if some of your questions were not answered up to now, we just made sure they're all answered now in written form. So please check back if you're curious. So Jack, now it's all yours.
Thank you, Tanja. I hope you can all see the screen. So following on from what Niko said, I'd like to present a survey of within host diversity for SARS-CoV-2. And as we've heard, you know, it's a single-stranded RNA virus with a high mutation rate. So to look at its diversity within samples, we downloaded a large set of nearly 6,000 samples from the SRA. And we then selected them based on the coverage. So as Niko mentioned, if you have higher coverage, you can detect lower frequency variants. And to complement that, we also looked at 749 samples from Switzerland, so from the samples we heard about from Tanja and Sarah, and these processed with VPipe that Niko just introduced. And to select the samples, we used quite stringent coverage cutoffs. So we wanted the median coverage of at least 1,000, so this gray line here. And the lower quartile we selected to be above 100, so the orange line above this dashed line here. And to not be too extreme, we also cut off very high coverage samples with an upper quartile above 10,000. So this means we can detect variants inside the single host down to, you know, percent or below a percentage frequencies. And then for the sample selection, we use this. And then across the genome, this is sort of how the coverage depends for the whole set of nearly 4,000 samples. You can see the average coverage is quite high because of the selection on the previous slide. And it's fairly high across most of the genome. There's a dip here at the end of the first gene, at the beginning of the spike gene. And this is regular patterns with the primers, which are the black lines at the bottom. So with this, we have a set of data with reasonably high coverage. We went to look at the diversity within samples, and to measure the diversity, we went for a very simple measure, the entropy. So just the frequency of the different bases in different positions times the logarithm of the same frequencies. And to visualize this is the public data. This is a kind of visualization of the diversity across these 4,000 samples across the genome. In the positions, we only picked ones which have at least diversity in at least 4% of the samples. So it's a selected subset of positions, not the entire genome here. And you can see there's these regions at the very beginning of the first gene, in the middle of the S gene, at the M gene here. We have large regions with diversity. This is about 20 bases wide here, and about 40 bases wide in the M gene. And there's other positions. This is one that actually came up in Katia's talk in the beginning, which have high diversity across many samples or individual bases with high diversity. And on the sample basis, you can see some samples at the top have a lot of diversity and some have lower diversity. To kind of compare this or validate this with the Swiss data, we make the same plot with the Swiss data with the 749 samples. And you can see certainly the regions which are affected, like this one here at the beginning of the first gene, the S gene and the M gene are very similar on the previous slide. There's some new regions which are affected here in Switzerland we didn't observe in the public data. And a lot of the individual bases we don't observe so much in the local Swiss data. Of course, this depends on the sequencing protocol, the coverage, and many other factors, what you can detect with the data. And we know here the Swiss data is all generated locally with the genomics facility in Basel in terms of the deep sequencing. It's all processed in a uniform way. Because we use the entropy here as a measure of diversity, we can then ask the question, how much of this diversity comes from deletions and how much comes from individual bases being substituted? Because the entropy is additive over the four bases and deletion, we can split this into the components. And to give you an idea of how this looks, this is the two heat maps we've seen before split into two columns. So the public data on the top, the Swiss data on the bottom. This is the entropy from deletions, and this is from the different four other bases. And you can see the strong signal here, these regions which are affected are mostly deletions. So this is low frequency deletions within the sample, so not a consensus deletion, but low frequency. And this also this one base here was mostly affected by deletions. And in the different base, you see there is still some entropy coming from the different bases. It's a weaker signal than deletions. But even within these regions, which are heavily colored by deletions, you still see there are individual bases which are substituted in these kind of highly diverse regions. We can summarize this entropy that we project down these heat maps onto the gene level. We can summarize the average entropy, or average diversity per gene. And this is what comes out. So here, top is the public data, the bottom is the Swiss data. You see gene-wide, the diversity is fairly evenly spread. Apart from here in the public data, the M gene is much more diverse, and the seventh open reading frame is less diverse. And on top of this, we plotted the most diverse regions, which are the dots. And these are the ones which we saw in the previous slides. There's these kind of vertical bars, and also the most diverse individual bases as these triangles. And we compared to the Swiss data, we see a similar pattern, slightly more amplified difference in diversity between genes. So here we see the difference between the first gene and the S gene. M gene is even more diverse compared to the other ones than we saw in the public data, and the seventh gene even less diverse. The positions or regions which had this high diversity, these seem to match, especially the main three, this one here, the first one, the one in the S gene and in the M gene, and some of the other ones too. But there are some differences too, especially in the positions which are highly diverse, these are more different between the public data and the Swiss data. Instead of projecting just gene-wise, we can actually predict either base-wise or sample-wise. And here we sum the original heat maps in two directions. So one is per position on the genome, and here is per sample, so summing horizontally. And this is just a histogram of the total entropy per position or per sample. And you can see on the raw scale, these have very heavy tails. So most of it is pretty low, and some samples have a lot of entropy, or some positions have a lot of the diversity. To make this a bit more viewable, we make a logarithmic transform of the entropy and then plot the same histograms in these inset plots here. You can see here it's roughly normal with a slight skew in the public data, but if it's normal on the log scale, again, you know there's going to be heavy tails in both in the positions and in the samples. And this basically means that most of the heterogeneity across samples, across loci, is focused or is contained within a small subset of samples and a small subset of loci. And then with the public data, we have a subset of the public data, about 1,000 samples. We had age and sex and also the country origin all came from Australia. So we wanted to see if the diversity was predicted by age and sex. And to do this prediction, we ran a linear regression model. We included sequencing covariates, so the sequencing properties, as well as the coverage covariates, so the median coverage and the interquartile range of the coverage. And this is the adjusted plot once we adjust for the other factors in our modeling. And you can see here that the age is a significant predictor of increased diversity. So over each decade, it increases by about 9% on average. And it's a kind of a strong trend with this amount of data, so a significant trend. There's a lot of variation that's not explained by age. You can see in the in the scatter plot, there's a lot of extra variation, but it's still this strong trend of increasing age predicting higher diversity. And of course, we know higher age has worse outcome for COVID-19. And the question, if we had the clinical data, you know, in between, is would this diversity be, you know, a mediator or moderator of the effect of age on outcome of SARS-CoV? To get an idea of this is, of how this replicates in the Swiss data, unfortunately we haven't got for the Swiss data all the clinical covariates, but we do have the distribution of ages in SARS-CoV tests in Switzerland as a whole. So this is a plot of the entire Swiss data from the Swiss public health authorities. And you can see over time, the average age of people being tested decreases. So in this plot, the younger ages take up a larger percentage and the younger ages go upwards and the older ages decrease. Because in the beginning of the pandemic, the sequencing focus was on the older populations, the more at-risk populations, and over time it became more widespread. So we can use this general trend in Switzerland of younger ages being sequenced at later times to give us kind of a proxy for age in our data. So we use this as a linear model to predict the age of patients based on time, on sequencing date. We have the sequencing date in our Swiss data. And if we use a predicted age and we plot that against the log total entropy, so the log diversity of the samples, we see again the same trend that increasing age correlates with higher entropy. So at least corroborates the finding we found in the public data. And with that, I'd like to wrap up a kind of summary of the findings we found on the Swiss data and the public data. We have put this onto the bioarchive, so there's preprints available at this address or with this QR code. I'd like to thank the team in Niko's group, in the Computational Biology group, as well as the collaborations with Christian's group, who did the sequencing, and Tanya's group, as you know from here. And thank you all for your attention and look forward to your questions.
Thank you very much, both of you. And indeed, there are some questions already in a Q&A, and please post any more you may have. So let me start maybe with the question for Jack on how sure are you that without the CT threshold values for these public samples, that these SNPs are actually biological plausible and not due to PCR resampling?
I mean, so we use the VPipe framework to try and filter out as much noise as we can. Of course, I mean, it doesn't remove all the confounding factors, all the noise, everything there. And it's a question of how deep do you want to go in terms of how reliable your findings. So we use the VPipe defaults for the deletions. We have a threshold of 0.5% in line with the simulation studies about where we can believe the detection. But yeah, certainly some very low frequency stuff will be noise. Hopefully majority is because real signal. And then if you want to be more stringent, you can always increase your cutoffs, your p-values you need for your detection. But we went with the defaults based on simulation studies that Niko presented in his talk.
And the entropy which you showed, the question is if VPipe also calculates that automatically or if you have to do something on top.
No, so we processed that afterwards. So we have from VPipe the VCF files which say each position, the frequency of the mutation or the substitution or deletion. And so the number of reads that support it and the number of reads which are reference. And so we just post-process that. I think it's easy to add, so EVAN to add to the pipeline, and as well as other measures as a diversity as well as entropy.
Just to add, the code we used to produce the results that Jack presented is also on GitHub and is available. It's not, you know, the computation of the entropy is not integrated into VPipe right now, but it's already available, let's say, and it's not a big calculation anyway, so.
People are in fact very interested in the VPipe tool. So I guess a couple short questions. So first, the input data for the VPipe, is it cleaned, trimmed reads, paired, unpaired?
No, it's the raw reads and trimming and whatever does VPipe or can VPipe do for you. And it can handle both single end or paired end reads.
And does it also work with amplicon nanopore data?
Yeah, I mean, it should, but it's fair to say we didn't really test a lot on nanopore data. So most of the development has been done in the context of Illumina reads. We also did process PacBio reads. So in principle, I guess it will work, but we don't have a lot of experience, and there's probably, you know, other types of behavior that one would need to look at more carefully, let's say. So we probably will put more emphasis on it in the future when it becomes more established, especially the more medical applications are still based very much on Illumina sequencing. That's why we also focus on it. But we see, of course, that the nanopore becomes more and more interesting and attractive to use.
And on VPipe, another question, if it also works for animal viruses.
Oh yeah, sure. I mean, you're really just providing the reference genome and the raw reads, and in principle, it can be any virus. Of course, we think of RNA viruses because, you know, there has to be some diversity for it to be relevant to do this type of analysis, but it's certainly not restricted to human viruses in any way. And in fact, we did at least one paper on swine fever, maybe a few others. At least we have a number of people in contact with us who are interested, even in plant viruses, so in different viruses. Yeah.
Great. Jack, for you is another a more biological question. How do you explain the observed correlation of entropy with patient age?
Yes, I guess at this stage we can't try to explain it. I guess we could think of different reasons. You know, if you have a higher viral load in the beginning, or the virus develops more inside, it could, you know, mutate inside the host more. This is why, as you mentioned before, Tanya, if we had the clinical metadata with these samples, there'd be a lot of interesting questions we could ask. Is it causal for worse outcome, or is it a consequence of being older that you get higher diversity because the virus mutates? At this stage, we have no idea. But hopefully, if we get such data, we could look into these questions.
Yeah, and I guess, for everybody not so involved in that, I guess really the crucial point with this data is not that it doesn't exist, but there's a lot of privacy concerns, and obviously not everybody going to get a test fills out a patient consent, not because people wouldn't do that, but most practitioners just don't, it's not set up such a study. So, but there are ways around, and different people in different countries work on that. With that, I would like to close this first eSymposium. Thank you very much for everybody being involved. Thank you very much for all your questions, interesting discussions for the people online. And stay tuned, there will be more eSymposia with a gap of a couple weeks always, so they'll be announced widely. So we hope to welcome you on one of the next eSymposiums. And for now, thank you very much for attending. Thank you in particular, Katia, for zooming in from the US, and have a good rest of the day, everybody.